This is Conor Lennon for UN News. Now, the international community agrees that we all have to move away from fossil fuels. They're contributing to the climate crisis, they're contributing to pollution. However, it's not very easy. Many countries are still heavily dependent on some of the dirtiest fossil fuels, such as coal, let alone oil and gas. But here on the island of Dominica, a potential solution is afoot. They've been working on it for a long time, but it is possible that this developing island state could become 100% renewable when it comes to electricity generation. Now, you may be wondering why I'm wearing a hard hat and a nice high-vis jacket. It's because I'm actually on the site of one of the first geothermal wells that have been constructed here. And I'm going to find out a lot more from one of the experts. I'm not a scientist, but Mr. Fred John knows all about the technical aspects of this, and he is the head of the Dominica Geothermal Development Corporation. Fred, thanks for coming here as well, and also thanks for sharing your hard hats with us, because we are still on a construction site. And this is where it all happens. So explain what this piece of kit is, first of all, and why this is so crucial to your plans.
Okay, so what we're looking at here is a geothermal well. But before we talk about the well, what's probably more important is what's beneath our feet, and that's the geothermal reservoir. So in this Rosa Valley, we have proven that there exists a really high quality geothermal reservoir, which can be used for generating electricity and other uses.
But when you say reservoir, for me, a reservoir is above ground, it's water. When you talk about reservoir in this context, what does that mean? You already said it's about a kilometer underground.
Yes. It's not that different to your understanding. It is fluid. The difference is that it's heated. It's very high temperature. In this case, it's about between 250 and 260 degrees Celsius.
Wow. And it stays that temperature all year round?
All the time. And it's also high pressure. That's important. Because if we were to open up this well, so this well is what we call a production well that's used to extract some of this liquid for generating electricity. If we were to open up this well, you would get a sense of the pressure that this reservoir has.
Okay, so that's the first stage. You build the well, you have access to this 250 degrees C fluid, which is coming up, it's high pressure. How do you turn that into electricity?
Well, from this well, we connect piping, so what they call a steam gathering system, to this well and run it to a power plant. In this case, our power plant is going to be about 300 meters down this way. That spins the turbine. Well, there's a few steps before that. But that energy is used to power a turbine, which then powers a generator. And voila.
Okay, which is kind of a traditional way of creating electricity. But the difference is that rather than using a polluting fuel like diesel or coal, it's 100% clean and 100% renewable.
Yes, and we have a similar well about 1.3 kilometers to the west of here, where the fluid that we extract here gets returned to the reservoir. So it's a closed loop system. So we have chosen the technology that is the most environmentally friendly to ensure that this really is a best in class.
Okay, in terms of the potential for this, this could power the whole island and more.
The reservoir could. This well, from the tests we've done, will generate about 10 megawatts, which is about 50% of our peak right now.
And the next step is after that to make sure that you get the electricity flowing around the island. I know that you still have some more money that's needed to be invested to reach that stage, but you clearly come a long way. You mentioned it's taken a long time. I spoke to the Minister of Energy, Dr. Vince Henderson, who of course you know well, a little earlier, and he explained a bit about the length of time it's taken to get where we are.
Yes. Vince Henderson, Minister of Foreign Affairs, International Business, Trade and Energy.
And tell us, where are we and why are we here, Minister?
Well, you're in the most beautiful geothermal site in the world, the Rosa Valley, Loda to be specific. And this is the most visited, should I say, tourist site on the island. Very beautiful, cool, pristine, and we hope it'll keep it that way.
But I would imagine not many tourists will come to exactly this spot that we're on now. What's happening right here?
Well, we are right here. This site is actually a site for reinjection for geothermal power plant. We chose geothermal not because it's easy. but because it has the potential to transform Dominica, not only for energy, but for livelihoods, creating more opportunities for businesses and of course reducing the cost of electricity to families. But of course, there's always the benefit of the environment, which is the primary benefit. That one, we're hoping we can maximize to get to the point one day where we will have 100% of our electricity demand being met by renewable energy. And I should say, before I continue on the geothermal path, we in the Roseau Valley, this is also the location of our hydroelectric power plant. And we already have 20, up to 30% on a good year of electricity being generated from hydropower.
But most of it's coming from diesel right now, which...
So the other 70% comes from diesel.
And like most island, I mean, it's normal. Most island countries have this.
Well, we're better than most island. We have 30% hydro, and that has been so since 1950. So we are already ahead, and we have some solar and some wind, but primarily we are slightly better than our neighbors, or even throughout the world.
But still, at the moment, majority diesel, it's expensive, I'm sure.
Very expensive, very expensive. Even with hydro, electricity rates in Dominica are pretty high, one of the highest.
So you must have done all of the studies. You told me that you've been working on this project, not for 10 years, not for 20 years. This has been going on for a long time, this idea. Tell me when the idea first started, and also why it's taken so long to get where we are now.
Well, I was hoping you would not say that I have been working on this from 1969.
No, not you. You're far too young. You're far too young.
But we have. But Dominica has been working, has been pursuing geothermal since 1969 with the assistance of the United Nations. Since 1969, studies were done, surface studies to determine the, to first determine that we have the potential for geothermal energy on the island. And then the efforts really went into government pursuing and looking at this together with the French territories. And by 1974, the government, through an act of parliament, created a Dominica Geothermal Company to develop geothermal energy. So we have been very ambitious from 1974. And also, you know, and those efforts continued up to the 90s when a concession was given to a company to develop geothermal in 1994. And unfortunately, nothing happened. By 2001, the government, with assistance from the Organization of American States, once again, started looking at geothermal. And that was an OECS-wide project where the Caribbean, where the countries in the Eastern Caribbean were being considered for developing geothermal. By 2008, the government of Dominica was able to secure funding. We were fortunate, we were able to get some funding. So we started doing a whole bunch of studies. And then by 2012, we were able to drill test wells, exploration wells, to determine that we really had the resource at commercially viable quantities, and we were able to prove that.
And the potential is huge. After these studies, you thought, wow, potentially we could not only power the whole island 100% renewable, but also sell this clean energy.
Yeah, well, I'll tell you, by 2001, 2002, we were told that we had over 3,000 megawatts of potential. It's not something I like to quote, because as I said to people, if we were to harness all that, we may have to drill where you live. So, but the fact is, the island has, you know, potential for power that goes way beyond our domestic needs. And even if we were to develop, you know, rapidly, we still won't be able to consume all that power.
And so, the cost of that energy, presumably, would be pretty low compared to where you are.
That is where most people are not doing geothermal, that we need to talk about. And why is it that Dominica has been so successful so far? So we have the potential, and we recognize that our neighbors have great demand for power. And that is, we like to say we're in the middle of Europe, because we have Guadeloupe to the north and Martinique to the south. And they're not that far away. So we started pursuing selling power to them via subsea cables. So we negotiated agreements with French companies, even Electricité de France, EDF. We started working with them by 2010, 2012, actually. we started negotiations with them so that we could sell power to Martinique and Guadeloupe. That is still an active consideration, but we have decided to pursue the construction of a plant to first meet domestic needs. But we have the potential. And the other thing that we're hoping that we will move to quickly is the production of ammonia and green hydrogen, which is really where the focus should be, moving away from connecting cables to actually producing fuel cells.
So for the region, you're pioneers, aren't you, for this transition to low carbon technology?
Well, we're in good company. Nevis, the island of Nevis, St. Kitts and Nevis, they were ahead of us in terms of test drilling. They did their wells before, but they had their own challenges. So they sort of fell back a bit, but they're moving ahead. And I know that progress is being made. St. Vincent and the Grenadines also, they drilled a few wells. They've not been as successful as Dominica, but they've also made investments. And Grenada has done some surface studies and hoping that they can move. St. Lucia had wells drilled in the 90s, but they were not successful.
And it's a lot of it's down to finance, and this is the big issue. Let's talk a bit more about finance and what we call climate finance.
Right. Let's talk about that.
Which I know many countries, including yours, have been calling for more assistance from larger economies at UN climate conferences and other forums. Let's talk a bit about that. I mean, it's not just a problem for you, it's a problem for your neighbors. When you have these discussions at international forums, what are you pushing for now in terms of help to move to a cleaner economy?
Well, that's a very, very complex, not the question, but the answer. So I'm trying my best to simplify it in my mind. But developing geothermal power is very expensive. It's very, very expensive, and even more so for small island states, because remoteness, the cost, this economies of scale, and all these things that we normally see in the literature, which are true. In our case in Dominica, we were fortunate because we got a combination of grants and concessional loans in order to get to where we are. So let's move now to climate financing. We are now accessing green climate funds from the Caribbean Development Bank and the Inter-American Development Bank to construct the power plant. But our biggest partner has been the World Bank and the government of the United Kingdom, at some point the government of New Zealand, and recently the US government have all contributed grant funding for technical support and sometimes for actual hardware in the case of the UK, where we were able to utilize $10 million for drilling. So the financing part has to be looked at in two separate, sections. One, we need to look at the actual initial work. Who finances that work that determines that in fact there is the resource? And that is where grant funding or some sort of contingent grant funding become very important. Very, very important. So all of the talk that is going on about renewable energy, especially with geothermal energy, if the international community is serious, there has to be some upfront investment by way of grant funding to determine those resources.
Minister Henderson, thank you so much for being with us today. And one of the wonderful things about this country is that it's so lush, but that does mean that you get a lot of rain. So I'll let you get out of the rain now.
Lot of rain, but I'm grateful for it because it means that the hydropower plant, you know, can get to the levels and the farmers must be very happy.
Well, let's find you an umbrella. So I was talking there to Dr. Vince Henderson, Minister of Energy, who you know well, talking about some of the frustrations that are inherent in this whole process because it's been going on for so long. You must be very happy that you've managed to get to the stage you're at now. But getting to the next bit, the bit of actually making it a reality, of actually having this very cheap energy, this clean energy, how long is that going to take, do you think?
From where we are now, less than 2 years.
Which is nothing compared to the time you've been waiting.
That's correct. The hardest part, the stage we're at now that we have not gotten to before, is we have a signed agreement for building the power plant, for building and operating the power plant. We've never gotten this far. So,
Dominica is going to be a really important country, isn't it, in the wider region. When this finally happens, you're going to get a lot of attention. I mean, 100% renewable. Not many countries can say that.
Well, we're all trying to get there. And we are blessed with the geothermal resources. We also have hydro. Right in this Rosa Valley, we also have 6 megawatts of hydro installed. So that's huge for us as well, to have both of those renewable sources at our disposal.
Right, as we were speaking, then we had a massive gust of wind. We get so many different seasons in one day, or in just a matter of a few minutes. You had rain, we've had sun and wind, and it reminded me of Hurricane Maria 2017, which devastated the economy here and caused huge damage. Of course, you were out of electricity for several months, I think, on the traditional, mainly diesel-based, but also you've got hydropower. When this is all up and running, will the country be more resilient? So when the next big storm comes through, are you confident that you'll be able to get electricity generation up and running in a relatively short space of time?
Yes, because there are two parts to this. One is the generation part. So
you are all underground.
Well, the generation is above ground,
but
it's rated for category 5.
Right.
So that part is fairly secure. The second part is getting the power from here to the load centers through a transmission network.
Yeah.
We are building a brand new transmission network. And two features of that are really important. One is that there is redundancy. So we literally have two circuits.
One can go down and the other one can carry things on.
And the second part of this is more than 60% of this entire network is underground. Maybe more than 70% is underground. So we feel very confident that we are making investments to build something that's resilient and can grow with the country as well.
You've been working on this for a while. What's the most exciting thing for you? Is it the fact that the energy will be clean, or the fact that it's cheaper energy for the citizens? You as a professional in this area, what really excites you about it?
I think because this gives the country a real shot to transform itself economically. And it's a broad-based type benefit. So the first step being cheaper electricity for everybody. So that's huge. But secondly, we are going to, based on the quality of the resource we have, we are going to monetize this beyond just cheaper electricity. So that brings revenue to the country and allows the entire island economy to rise. So.
Well, I wish you all the luck, and we're almost there. 2 years is nothing compared to the time you've been waiting. So we look forward to the next step in this process of 100% renewable Dominica. Fred, thank you very much for being with us today.